So, welcome back, all of you, to this more intimate small room that gives a lot more comfort. So, I hope you all enjoyed the inaugural session, like the speeches. I think we are now moving to a four-part technical series. These panel sessions that we'll be having between today and tomorrow will cover some of the key conference theme and topics that are quite relevant to drive the discussions around certification and capacity building. The first session that we have is a topic of importance, which is the importance of certification, capacity building, and financial markets. It's setting the tone for the rest of the sessions. In this particular session, the panel members will discuss the importance of certification in strengthening financial markets, ensuring investor protection, building investor confidence, and expanding financial markets, and also about enhancing employment opportunities, which is, I think, a big theme of this new government. The session will also focus on the needs to strengthen a broad consensus across financial sector institutions on the need to prioritize certifications, education and knowledge initiatives for market professionals as a minimum business essential. The moderator of this session is a well-known public figure, somebody who's been in the regulatory body for a long, long time and will provide significant insights. Mr. Prashant Sir, who was the whole-time member of SEBI. A little bit about Mr. Sir. Mr. Sir held the position of the Chief General Manager in charge with the Reserve Bank of India. He was heading the Department of Banking Operations and Development during 2005 to 2009. And he was responsible in that role for regulating commercial banks. He was also instrumental in drafting the National Strategy for Financial Education. Mr. Sarang has held membership in a number of committees like the International Liaison Group, the International Liaison Group on Capital for Basel Committee on Banking Supervision, National Advisory Committee on Accounting Standards, and the Empowered Committee on External Commercial Governance. I would now like to hand over the session to Mr. Sarang to carry forward this discussion. Welcome, Mr. Sarang. Invite the key panel speakers for this session, Mr. Balakrishna Kini, Mr. Navneet Munot, Mr. Paritosh Sharma, Mr. Richard Stockdale, and Mr. Vineet Arora to join Mr. Sarang in this discussion.
Before introducing my honorable colleagues, I will give my first remarks and then we will introduce and then we will throw open the session. So I thought let me share my views first. All of you would have heard of Mona Lisa, and it's called a masterpiece. And there are a lot of other paintings and sculptures which are called masterpieces. It's quite interesting to know that why a masterpiece is called a masterpiece. For knowing that, it will be necessary to go a little back in history and see how the guilds in Europe operated. The guilds in Europe operated on a principle that that each profession had a guild of its own, and there the young boys, they used to join the guild as apprentices, and they were attached to a master. And these guys, they used to serve the master for about 5 to 7 years, learning the trade. And then when they had learned the trade enough, then they were given the status of a journeyman. So these journeymen, they their status was very interesting. They were supposed to go around, they were not supposed to come back for next 5 years to the place where they belong, within 15 miles of that. They were supposed to journey, they were supposed to go from one place to another, practicing their profession, and they were bound by very strict rules of conduct. And not only professional conduct, of personal conduct. They could not get into a public room. They had to dress up in a particular way. So the journeymen had their own dresses and all those things, or uniforms. After they have done their part, they will come back to their place. And then they will start working on a piece of art or a piece of machinery, which will be a unique thing to be done. And when that piece was made, and it was submitted to the guild or the academy, and it was accepted, then it was called a masterpiece. So many of the most famous paintings, they were actually submitted as a masterpiece to the academy, and then the guy was given the status of a master. So although when I started with Mona Lisa, Mona Lisa was not a masterpiece. It was not submitted as a piece for getting admission into a guild. But that was the status. Now, why I am telling you all this story from medieval period? The point which I am trying to make here are two. One is this, that the institution of guilds and the excellence they engendered in the entire ecosystem in Germany was greatly helpful in the industrial revolution picking up in that part of the world. There were master craftsmen who could adapt themselves to the new technology, and all those things could happen, so there was the economic part. The second point I told you on this story is the fact that the guilds, that system, provided a complete ecosystem of training, right from the level of master to the level of apprentice. So the entire ecosystem was being there as a training and excellence unit. So that is the first point. And then I happened to read the two reports. One is a book, one is a book. The report is a 2015 Department of Commerce report in USA, and that's about certification. And those certification reports, what they said was that there are pros and cons, there are pluses and minuses, and there are too many certifications, and in some states in US you need a certificate, 8 states of them, where you need a certificate to become a funeral attendant. And there's one state where you need a certificate to become a first. So this was a kind of a thing, and then they were saying that it imposes a cost on the immigrants, and the cost in the market is there, and the lower end of the labor force is excluded out, and all those things. So this was 2015 report of the Department of Commerce, very much at the moment. And on the other hand, I read Wealth of Nations by Adam Smith, 1776. Chapter 10, Part 2. The arguments given there are almost similar to whatever was there in the 2015. So, the sum total is this. Neither the issue of certification is new, nor the controversies around certifications are new. Here we have to see that development ecosystem which is helpful to the country, to the world, to the economy, and also as it develops everybody, So this is the sum total of it. And I am no expert in certification. And we have got all experts here for certification. And the guru of everybody is here, Mr. Prithosh Sharma, who has been in this field for more than 25 years. He has been acting as a consultant. And he heads the School of Certification of NISM, and which, as you would know, that is certifying more than 150,000 certification certificates in a year. So, Mr. Prithosh Sharma is a recognized expert. Mr. Navani Muno is there. He is a CIO of a very important SBI mutual fund. He has been in this area for a very long time, and his area uses certification for the distributor, has been using certification distributors for a very, very long time. Mr. Vinod Arora is the Executive Vice President and Head of the Product Distribution of the ICICI Securities. He is a person who is there in touch with everybody, all the retail investors, millions of them, and he knows the requirements on both the sides of the relationship managers, talking to the investors and the requirement of the investor. So we have got a very, very important person there to talk to you about questions. Mr. Kini is from MFI. He both the PCO and now he's the head of, or acting head of MFI. And Mr. Kini is an old hand. I mean, I don't say that he's very old, but he's a very experienced hand in mutual fund. He has been instrumental in getting the issue of distributor certification his comments will be extremely useful to us. Last but absolutely not least, Mr. Stockley, he has worn so many hats, and he has been a banker, and he has been in so many issues like anti-corruption and anti-money laundering. So he has got a very, very experience, and he brings international flavor to the discussion. So the format which we have decided for this panel is this, that we will ask each member to speak for about 5 to 10 minutes, and then maybe we will go through some questions within the panel, and then we will throw it open to the audience for the session. I hope that you will be good. So I will first request Mr. Prithosh to talk.
That you hear about the 2015 report and the analyst report, I guess we have to look at critical functions that we consider. Obviously, the forest is not a critical function that we need. So, I am really going to talk about, we have a lot of colleagues of mine here who are from various organizations that provide certification as well. NISM certifications are at a basic entry level. They are licensing examinations. So I thought the first perspective that I would like to share with you is the importance of the licensing exams. It's difficult to call it licensing in India because individuals are really not registered. So we have been calling it certifications and mandatory certifications. Since individuals are not licensed, they're really not licensing exams. But the reason why they are there, and the reason why the regulation that the chairman also spoke about was came about in 2007 is because India has been grappling with this issue of limited investor participation. So we had wonderful markets have been created. Technology has done wonders for our exchanges and clearing corporations and depositories. We are paperless and cashless. However, the investor participation was not really moving at the same pace, and obviously the idea is to create an ecosystem, create trust, and as the chairman said, trust is the most critical thing to markets, and so did Mr. Baker. So to get that, the investor protection being the objective of the regulator, so professionalizing the industry is the way in which you can protect the investor and increase investor confidence, and therefore with increasing confidence their participation in the markets will go up. And I said licensing certifications, important with licensing, just to make it understandable for everybody. These are entry level certifications which are required for people to work in the markets. When we started in 2007-8, before that, I'm calling it pre-NISM. Market functions were not defined, so we had operations and we had sales and compliance, but nobody knew what they were going to do there. So if people wanted to join the industry as a compliance person or as an operations person, he did not know what he needed to do to get there, because there was no profession, there was no understanding of. So you had to join and then learn on the job. And similarly, the employers are also going to recruit and then hope that this person is going to learn over time. This is not a professional market. So how, the market, professionalism in the market would come when jobs are defined. We know what is expected of a person in a particular profession. And that's what we did. So when NISM has started, the first and the most important thing we've done is to look at these jobs and defining these jobs for the first time in India. So there was nothing known, and now we have job definitions. So, and the body of knowledge which for these market functions was also developed. Curricula, learning materials, and which support text takers. We have workbooks and we have training materials, so which helps people understand what it takes to work in a particular function. The second thing that happened with NISM was that training as a profession did not exist. So when you don't have securities markets as professionals, then obviously there is no training. Training was also haphazard and disorganized. Now that changed when you create a mandate and a requirement for an exam, and people know that they have to enter the industry, they have to take this exam. And then trainers come and training organizations are created, and that has created a profession of training, and many of our people who are here today are a part of that profession, and they would attest to this fact that things have changed in the last 7-8 years in securities market training. And that's, I think, a big achievement as well of the entry level licensing examinations, which have started and kick-started this move towards improving professional knowledge. Our exams are developed and administered in association of industry. Just a quick look, we've been talking about 22 exams. So we are covering critical market functions, and florist is not there. It's in the range of sales and mutual funds and advisory operations and compliance. A question that I had was, these are some numbers, 9,000 brokers in India, and plus their employees, we don't know how many. 50,000 sub-brokers plus their employees, we don't know how many. Maybe Mr. Kinney, I'm right when I say 100,000 distributors around that number. And 50,000 people join the industry annually. And we have 600,000 individuals that have been certified, and 150,000 happening annually. So numbers don't seem to really add up. Are we true? Are we finished? So 600,000 covers seems to cover everything. Why are we not really able to understand? So, we really don't know how many people are there. I think that's an issue that we have to grapple with, I think, next. We don't register individuals, so we really don't know who's working in what function. And therefore, we don't know whether he is competent. So we know so many people are taking exams, we're really not able to relate to how many, whether they are working in the business or not. That is not so true perhaps in country mutual fund distributors, because we know that mutual fund distributors take this exam and they distribute mutual funds. But on the exchange side, there is this hole in derivative sales, which is a critical area in relation to investment. That's something which perhaps we can discuss. We have a grandfathering provision which is ongoing, which means anybody with a 10-year experience doesn't need to take the exam, get certified through a training program, which I think the industry needs to now understand. After so many years, we need to increase gradually the level of knowledge we expect our sales staff and our professionals to have. So we are looking for support from the industry there, hoping that we are going to be able to gradually increase the threshold, because that's where we have to gradually, you know, we have to increase, improve the state of our markets, means improve the knowledge of our professionals. Going forward, we see, you know, we are in a great opportunity to support the expansion of this market, but we need to upskill professionals continuously to be able to sustain investor confidence. And we are looking to provide higher level and specialized training and certifications to support career progression. One of them was launched today in front of you. And also look at providing broad and comprehensive certifications like the Series 7 in the US, and using the reach of the media. Thank you.
Now, shall I request Mr. Navneet Mano?
We're talking about the importance of certification capacity building. This audience is like converting the converted. Those of you who are spending 2 days in Patalganga, I'm sure, already know and appreciate the importance of certification and the capacity building. But I still thought that given this tagline, learning from the past and preparing for the future, maybe from a little bit of my understanding of the recent past and then obviously the future, and in that context, where does the certification and these things fit? A lot of people think that India doesn't have the equity cult, a very small part of the population invest in equity. You know all the numbers, 3-4% is still out of 1.3 billion people. There are, the chairman talked about less than 50 million followers for mutual fund and all that. I think we don't appreciate the fact that actually we're a great equity cult. I mean, several of you would remember the early 90s. I think in the early 90s when King was there in UTI, I think MasterGain collected, correct me if I'm wrong, 4,000 crores, right? Or some such number. 4,500 crores. Now, one NFO collected 4,500 crore rupees. And compare that in 1991-92, the GDP of India, the market capitalization of India, and then they collected. In today's terms, that would be something like a new fund offering is there and you collect 25,000 crores or something. Is it even like kind of something that you can think about? No, I mean, how can an AMC raise that kind of money? It's impossible. But that's the kind of equity cult we had in our country. People talk about the crowdsourcing today, but I think we invented crowdsourcing in 1990s. Almost every single day, on an average, there used to be an IPO. There were like a couple of IPOs every week for several years, where a small rolling mill in Indore, or maybe a small hosiery producer in Ludhiana, a small textile guy in Coimbatore, some marble guy in Hyderabad, or some aquaculture guy somewhere else, were coming out with an IPO and people were investing. That's the kind of equity cult, that's the kind of capital market we had. We didn't have the dematerialization, we didn't have so many things. But what really went wrong to me, I think somewhere, is that I think maybe it was the lack of training. And there could be two reasons where lots of these companies did survive, people lost money in capital markets, and maybe it's taking for us a long, long time and the huge hard work that SEBI has put in and the entire industry has put in to get back to maybe where we are going now. But maybe I think if we look back and as we're learning from the past, maybe it's not that the advisors or the investment bankers or the managers who sold those IPOs or sold those funds or sold those products or corporate deposits where hundreds of them defaulted, were actually had a wrong intention. Not that they were fraud or they were they were trying to dupe the investor. A large part of the country, these advisors live next door. They know that we are going to be together for a long time and they don't want to cheat. It's just that they didn't know what they were doing. And I think that's where it's very, very critical that over a longer period, today when this whole digitalization of finance is happening in our country, which I believe will lead to financialization of savings, it's very critical that the people in our industry, they are very, very well trained. And unless that happens, I think again we'll make the same mistake. Something like 91, 92 or 2000 will happen, and again probably that will take us back by another 10 or 20 years. The another thing I think learning from the global experience, for example, whether the LIBOR scandal or what happened in subprime in 2007-8, people in our industry keep talking about the four most dangerous words. You know that? The four more dangerous words in financial markets? This time is different. I think the five most dangerous words are everyone else is doing it. And whatever, let's say, one market participant is doing, the second market participant does it, and third guy does it, and that becomes a market norm without realizing that are we doing something right or are we doing something wrong. As like Buffett said after 2008, that people were putting blame on each other, on regulators in some places, rating agencies, market participants, investment bankers, issuers, investors, advisors. But as Buffett said, that when the tide got over, all of us were swimming naked. And I think that's very, very critical. I think some of these trainings, apart from what they teach you in terms of the markets or whatever the valuation or some of those things, I think they also bring that aspect where you really understand what you are doing. And I tell you from my personal experience, in India, as I said, the learning from the past, what has happened that if you have read the Malcolm Gladwell's book, which talks about that how people are lucky, like all the veterans in Silicon Valley, the one thing in common, if you look at Steve Jobs, Bill Gates, Vinod Khosla, MacMillan, I mean all these guys, there's one thing common in them, they were all born in 1954-55. Each one of them were born in 54. Because it just so happened that when they were in high school, when they were in university, things were just moving in that direction that they were at the right time, at the right place. If they were a little older, they could not have made it. If they were a little younger, they could not have made it. And the history goes back, I think, whether it's the railroad pass, they were in 40s at that point in time when the revolution happened. If you were a little younger or a little older, you could not have benefited. I think something similar has happened in India. And the thing to learn is, I think some of us who were very lucky to come into the industry in the early 90s were a huge beneficiary. The foreign institutional investors started coming in, NSE got set up, you had the online trading, computerized trading, you had the dematerialization in 2-4 years time, and the city worked very fast. So you had the mutual fund regulation, almost like, it is difficult to remember, we have 44 mutual funds, I think we had almost 35, 36, even in late 90s, a lot of them have just changed colors. But you had so many of mutual funds coming in, insurance companies coming in, derivatives coming in, so many things, commodity futures, so on and so forth. So we were like very lucky that in my early 30s, I became a senior fund manager and then a CIO at very, very early age. And I think that gives you an overconfidence to start believing that, yeah, because you have learned and you know it and that's why you are there. And I remember when I applied for CFA and when I used to apply for an exam leave when I'm a CIO, there used to be like in office, everybody used to laugh. Even at my home, my daughter will say when I say let's go for dinner, Papa, what is this? You study, this is what you tell your daughter. And in the exam hall, I see the people who I've interviewed as a junior analyst or associate is there and I'm also writing exam. But I think that put pressure and that probably created in our organization a culture that if I'm doing it, then everyone else should also do it. I remember initially a lot of my analysts and fund managers that we have done CA, we have done MBA, we've been there in the market for 10 years. And I asked them, what do you read? We read so many books, they read all, right from Buffett to Howard Marks to whatever, everything, and then all the reports. And then another interesting, the internet gives you an illusion of being very intelligent because everything is like Google, so it gives you a great illusion of being very intelligent. And then like quite interesting, but then one after another, everybody realized the importance of doing that. And later on, I realized it's not only about the analyst or the fund managers or maybe some senior guys in the risk management, but every single guy. So we did another program called Claritas of the CFA Institute, where you have to go and give exam because whatever all those workshops and whatever the trainings and the knowledge series for 1 or 2 hours, I think don't have an impact unless you really go and take the exam. That's, I always believe, very, very critical. And I forced even my secretary to take it. And she was like, sir, what do I mean, what I have got to learn about it? And after the exam, because almost like 15% is about ethics, and then you learn about the insider trading, and all 35 people are doing, they're all junior guys in operations and risk management and product and all. And the whole language in the office for those couple of days when people are giving exam. And then she said, now I realize that if you are traveling to Patal Ganga and somebody asks where is Navneet, I'm not supposed to tell him, because of course here I'm for NISM. I could have come for another plant visit here. I could have come for a company meeting. Then now I understand that I'm not supposed to say where you are while traveling. Otherwise the broker will ask, and then I'll just say that he's gone to whatever, some such place. So the small things, or let's say the small thing like a Diwali gift where, I mean, we give so much of business to the brokers. If you're sending a box of chocolate or sweets or a book, how does it really matter? You start understanding the conflict of interest, why we are saying that we won't accept anything. And it becomes very, very easy across the organization to make some of those things understand. So I think probably from that perspective, learning from the past. A very little bit, if I'll take maybe 2-3 more minutes in terms of going into the future. Now, as I mentioned that in the last 20 years, we have really moved at a very, very fast pace, I would say, and as chairman was saying in morning, and the video was shown that where we were in late 80s, early 90s, and where we are today. But I'm sure there is an ambitious agenda going forward. See, we have just come out with this InvITs regulation. We have the Infrastructure Investment Trust. The chairman has been talking about the REITs. You will have SOAP, the commodity derivatives that got introduced today, because you'll have maybe a huge market in derivatives in India, and commodities market will be flourish and all that. But for large number of advisors and all, this will remain an alphabet soup, maybe a REIT or InvIT or whatever. Even globally, there is a study where the advisors were asked that why you don't sell the alternative products like some of these. And actually people think that they are complicated. Maybe they actually might be less risky and maybe more appropriate for an investor. It may be more appropriate to invest in REIT rather than investing in a plot of real estate somewhere here from a risk-adjusted basis. But they don't advise, and some people say maybe they are very high fees, some people say lack of transparency, some people think they are very complicated. The large number of people, the reality is the lack of understanding. And I'm talking of globally, where these things have been there for a very, very long time. And even there, a lot of people don't sell this product because they think they lack of understanding. And unless there is a proper understanding, how would people sell? Otherwise, the same thing will happen, like as I mentioned about the 80s and 90s, where wrong thing will be sold to wrong people at the wrong time, and then again you put blame on either SEBI or maybe a mutual fund or somebody else that he's made that mistake. But otherwise, that training is very important. And maybe going a little bit more into the future, I strongly believe that if a computer, IBM Watson, can defeat the chess grandmaster, nobody in the world can beat IBM Watson in the game of chess. If the best tennis player in the world cannot beat, I forgot the name of that robot, you cannot beat on the table of table tennis. Why it won't happen that the artificial intelligence and robotics won't play a very big role in financial markets? They will have their own impact in terms of where the markets are, what really happens to the way you look at the securities and all that. And unless really we look at that future and see that how relevant we will be, whether as an advisor or as an investment banker or as a trader or as a fund manager or as an analyst, remaining relevant in that period where our competition could be from completely different set of people or other machines, I think we have to remain relevant. We have to keep getting trained almost every single day. So when I do the induction program, I always say, tell people only just remember two things in your career: read more, meet more, keep learning and keep meeting, and that's very important, and on that happy note, and then I think it's very, very critical and couldn't have happened at a probably more, opportune time. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Navneet, for getting us to the future from the past. And you made a very important point of certification leading to correct discussion happening in the workplace. I think at this moment I should request Solicitor Stockton to make his initial remarks, because one of his hats is on the anti-corruption.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. And first of all, just to open my hopefully brief discussion with a comment that I think our moderator here made two very pertinent points of view. He talked about the Mona Lisa. You know why the Mona Lisa is famous? Apart from being a masterpiece, it's because her eyes always follow you. Now that's a good regulatory condition. Secondly, he talked about guilds. The guilds are alive, kicking, and very healthy. I'm a member of one, and in fact, if you look at the guild, the whole guild situation was, as I won't go into this long, but it was built up in the time medieval, as was mentioned, but it still carries right way through because it's relevant. It's relevant because the same way as we all grew up in families, with parents looking after us, the guild just replicates that in a professional manner. And in fact, I'm representing also this, particularly this morning, the CISI, the Chartered Institute of Securities and Investment, which was chartered by Queen Elizabeth only in 2009. It was born out of the Big Bang on the Stock Exchange, and is all about promoting ethics, integrity, and professionalism in the financial services workspace. And it's no accident that our chairman, Sir Alan Yarrow, was the Lord Mayor of London. Lord Mayor of the City of London, I should say. There's two Lord Mayors. One is a political appointment who runs London, which was the infamous Boris Johnson until recently. And there's then the Lord Mayor of the City of London, which is a product of the guilds. He comes up through the guilds, and then he basically, whoever, or he or she, because there have been lady Lord Mayors as well. And that person is responsible for the workings of the City of London. The Guild Hall, where we, when the CISI has its, many some of its celebratory functions, is a beautiful building, and this was the headquarters of the guilds. And so therefore, the guilds are really important, because they actually were capacity builders in the early years. Because if you build capacity, what does that actually mean? It means that you are building the ecosystem or the environment where people can flourish, become professional, and have options of how they do that. Whether it's example, whether it's through just, you know, normal training, or whether it's extra qualifications, learning, and so on and so forth. So this is very important. Thank you for mentioning that. Going back to capacity building and the position of regulators in that. I'm a banker, or I'm a retired banker. I'm also born and brought up in India, so I have a reason to be here as well. I'm very educated, you know, as a Lloyds banking manager at one point. To become a really effective market of practitioners, well, kindly, but firmly, remember Mona Lisa's eyes, firmly regulated, is a two-way street. It's in fact a normal pyramid and an inverse pyramid, because the instruction doesn't just flow down from the top to the bottom, it should flow down from the bottom, go up from the bottom to the top. What I mean by that is the reputation of countries as markets are dictated by the reputation of their jurisdictions and their institutions. And the reputation of jurisdictions, the reputation of jurisdictions in that market, or in that country rather, and the institutions are dictated by the inhabitants of those sectors. So we actually have an immediate flow down from country to an individual. And if the individual then decides to act well, to seek professional training, to seek qualifications, to do better, for himself, better for society, that in turn aids the jurisdiction and the institution which aids the country. Now, I'm not going to talk about various countries here, because it would be inappropriate, but we all know countries in the world where you wouldn't put a dollar under any circumstances. And you know countries in the world where you would put a dollar, and a lot more. And the reason is exactly that flow, that two-way flow, up, down, 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 two-way. So I think that this, in fact, gives an excellent opportunity for governments, jurisdictional regulators, and so forth and so on, to actually create scenarios where if they can provide the environment where they have the ability to give the populace, the individuals within that sector, the right or the opportunity to study and to qualify and to enhance their professional capability, that is the opportunity they have. That's their side of the contract. What's the other side of the contract? The other side of the contract is primarily that the individual should be held accountable. We know they are, but do they really realize, do they know they are, should they actually always aware when they wake up in the morning, not with guilt, not with fear, with confidence of their professionalism, but knowing that if they fall for their own lack of professionalism, they will be held accountable. And that is very important, because that means that's the other side of the contract. If they know they're going to be held accountable. I was giving a paper for, I think it was the UN actually, in Italy, on anti-corruption. And anti-corruption is a strange thing, because actually the first corrupt act is usually quite small, and the avarice comes in, and then you realize that you can get away with a bit more, and so on and so forth. I said, look, there's many ways to skin a cat, there's many ways to judge a situation, but one is fairly unfair. Would you want your mum to read in the paper the next morning what you did? Think about it. That's a very, very good line in the sand, isn't it? And that, in many ways, is that guilt thing. You know, I'm not a journeyman. I suppose I was a journeyman. I'm actually going to apply someday, I think, for the freedom of the City of London, because it has a rather exciting and privileged character. You can herd sheep over London Bridge. I've never actually wanted to herd a sheep over London Bridge, but I really want to do it now. So I've got an opportunity to become a freeman in the City of London. That's beside the point. The real point is that the guilds, your family, the ecosystem around you, if they're holding you accountable and you are proud of your professionalism, that is a self-motivator. And that, if you are in an environment where that is built up, that is capacity building in its true sense. You know, I used to have a business with probably one of the top academics in the world around financial crime, alternative value transfer systems, Kuala, Hundi, put it what you want. And he used to always position this, that you know you ain't right, so don't do it, however much temptation. If you don't do it because you ain't right, then you are okay, and society will be okay, and your jurisdiction will be okay, your institutions will be okay, and your country will be okay. That is capacity. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard, for such an enlightening comment. And really, this is one point which I wanted to bring out, that the necessity is to build the entire ecosystem and not a part of the system. And so we have talked about so well. Next, I would request Vineet to make his comments, because I think Vineet is most qualified person to talk there, because he's the person who deals with their customers on the other side and so on.
Vineet. Thank you, Mr. So I just give a brief of, you know, how we interact with different stakeholders, and you know, where does certification capability really fit in the entire ecosystem. So one is, you know, at ICICI Direct, we have a large number of investors who join us, and really about 80% of them are first time into the capital markets. So it's, you know, really brings us a lot of experience where we can say that, you know, what makes them take the first step, or what really goes into it when they really take the first step to start investing in the equity markets or in the capital markets. And the second part is, you know, we have our own team members, people who join us. So we're like an industry participant who really, you know, hire people who are certified and who need to be certified, or who are well, you know, gradually upgrading the skills, etc., on the entire thing. So that side, you know, we have experience on that side as well. Plus, we also have an agent force, etc. So, you know, how do they see certification on that side? And thirdly, you know, we have a institute that we started internally, and I said that it's Center of Financial Learning. With the prime objective of, you know, creating more and more investor education initiatives and covering more and more investors, as well as creating, you know, better and more number of financial professionals who are, you know, more qualified and better equipped to take this industry forward. So first, I think from an investor angle, and that's, I think, the clear critical part, and, of course, really, that's where it all starts. So, I mean, for an investor, when he comes first time into an equity market, some of them are, you know, I would say, fortunate, with families who have been investing and, you know, who have been doing things like that. But most of them are first time, and they do not understand what they're getting into or what they want to invest in, what is the goal that they're looking at, what should they do when they're evaluating something. So there is, you know, very little understanding which is there at an investor level. There's a parallel initiative of investor education, which obviously is going on. A lot of work has happened around that. But at the first time, he needs a level of validation. He needs somebody to talk to him, make him understand on, you know, the entire integrities, how things will work, what can he expect, what he's choosing for investment, even if it's a mutual fund or it's a stock or whatever he's choosing, has he chosen understandingly fully or not. And that's where I think the entire issue of implementation comes in very strongly. And it comes in the thing that the person who's talking to him, the person who's guiding him, is he qualified enough? Is he qualified enough? Is he dependable? Can the investor trust him? And, you know, so certification here comes in very, very critically, because if there's a certification, and that certification is also known to the investor that, you know, this certification implies a certain level of standards, then, you know, that really, you know, falls in place, and he knows that, you know, this person really knows what he's talking in, and I can trust him, and I can then go with him. I can ask him questions, or I can get an explanation for the same. So I think that's a very critical thing, and ongoing, you know, this journey just starts at that point, and then it has to carry on, because it's not just beginning which is important, but full journey which is important. So as an industry participant, I would say that, you know, when we look at people who are joining us, or after they've joined us and they get into, you know, managing investor relationships. So one is obviously the entire entry level of licensing that is required, and, you know, they can start doing business, they can start working. And so, you know, there are some places where policies, you know, kind of do it as part of the curriculum. Some places we have to take care of it. So that's okay. So, you know, ultimately you kind of get up a starting point and then you start doing business. But then, you know, it is, so most of the certifications today really focus on domain and regulation and stuff like that. What second aspect which is required to be really brought in is also a lot of soft skills. So it's not just about, you know, domain. So, I mean, I might be a very good domain person, but I might not be able to, you know, talk to an investor properly if I don't understand what he really needs. And then understanding is not just about domain, it is also a bit about, you know, listening capabilities, soft skills, and, you know, how we really open up with him and stuff like that. So I think that also needs to be really, you know, good. And as an organization, what we do is we really encourage a lot of certifications. So, like, a person qualifies and gets into a, you know, CFP, then, you know, we have more positive enforcement for them, so increments and promotion and stuff like that. So that's really, you know, part of culture of our organization. But now coming, you know, to the third aspect, where we have a lot of experience in creating new professionals and, you know, doing a lot of investor education. So there, you know, the certification, we feel that it's extremely important. But I would just really, you know, step into saying that, you know, what do we feel needs to be done more? One is that, you know, when we do a certification, we go through the entire programs, see a clear difference between themselves. So they can evaluate themselves and say that, you know, what I've gone through has, you know, made me reach a different level, and now I am a different person, you know, or a coach investor, you know, whatever job he's doing, he can do it. The issue is the industry or the entire ecosystem reciprocating, so that there is enough pull for people to come in for advanced certification. Licensing is one side, which is mandatory, so it just happens. You have to do it, otherwise you can't start. But after that, you have to get future, you know, more advanced qualifications. Is the industry or the ecosystem going to recognize that? And with that, get recognized, will, you know, result in better career enhancement. And that ecosystem, I think, we have to create, and that's responsible for all of us to create, including institutions which are doing certification, because, you know, to make it more popular is also important, because if it's not popular, then the investors don't value it, the organizations don't value it, and if that value is not there, then, you know, people won't go critical part that, you know, we must all debate and think, you know, how we together create an ecosystem which values certain certification and benchmarks them to standards, and people can expect certain standards from certain certification. But these are some 3-4 critical aspects which I, you know, do hope that we discuss today and maybe, you know, take it forward and take it up when we, you know, go back to our thoughts going forward. And clearly, is there a need for certification? And the answer is yes, there is definitely a need for certification. Without intermediation, will you be able to, you know, write the objective of financial inclusion? That also, I think, very clearly answer is that no, you cannot write financial inclusion without intermediation. Because there is a need for somebody to, you know, get that person to start and then you can go throughout the journey. So then these are core objectives which our nation, I think, has to be focused so that, you know, we have a much more evolved market. And for them, and hence you come back and using the certification. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Vineet, so much. And Kini, who is the CEO of NC.
Good afternoon. First of all, I thank NISM for inviting me to be one of the panelists here. I am from Association of Mutual Funds in India, and I've been brought just after my graduation, I've been in the mutual fund industry. The live mutual funds. After working for about 25 years in the industry, I am now back in the association, so I think I am going to die in the mutual fund industry. So, mutual funds, whenever we come out with any kind of a communication, they're supposed to say, as per the SEBI regulation, mutual funds are subject to market risk. Please read the scheme of the documents carefully. So, likewise, before I start, I must start with a disclaimer. Mr. Sankaran said, you know, all these people are experts, including me. I am not an expert. So that's the first disclaimer. And I thought, since I am from the industry and Lampi had been a pioneering institution in bringing about the certification even before it became mandatory, I thought I'll give you a perspective from the mutual fund industry point of view, because even the chairman in the morning session gave, he applauded the industry for doing a good job. So, first is the genesis. The SEBI chairman mentioned investor protection is the core of SEBI's ethos. In addition, even in the other two objectives of SEBI, promoting and developing the securities market and the regulation, there also the central theme is investor protection. So, that is the background. So the quality of intermediation in security market is very vital. Just now Namit mentioned why intermediates are required, and there is a requirement of handholding for the common investors. So it forms a basis for investor confidence. Investors' perception on quality intermediation depends on the conceptual and practical understanding of the intermediaries and their ability to provide fair and competent advice. And I'll explain this in a moment why. So therefore, it was felt imperative that the persons engaged in promoting the capital market products have necessary professional standards and are willing to continuously upgrade their skills, which would bring about an improvement in the quality of intermediation. That's the background. So back in 1990s, there was hardly any formal educational or training programs in securities market, other than perhaps UTI Institute of Capital Market, which subsequently became NISM, and it was formed in 1989. But in the 90s, when SEBI was established in 1992, and the early part of SEBI itself, SEBI acknowledged that the market transformation can be sustained and further reforms can be facilitated if there were adequately trained personnel who were willing to continuously update their professional competence. And taking into account international experience and the needs for the Indian markets, if you remember, SEBI was formed just around the time of Harshad Mehta's scam. So there were a lot of scams, there were mis-selling, etc. So SEBI proposed a certification exam for persons operating in the securities market, and as such standardization will assure the clients dealing with such persons about the level of knowledge. In other segments, if you remember, there were arrangements to equip the personnel with the required expertise. For example, banking and insurance is always taught in the schools and colleges. But mutual funds, even today, are not part of the school college curriculum. Insurance industry, a person is required to undergo specified hours of training and pass a prescribed exam. And likewise for banks also, there is a bank licensure or certification by Indian Institute of Bankers. However, back then, the development of capability of intermediaries providing professional service in the security market was by and large left to the market forces. Thus, with a view to improve the investor protection through better quality intermediation, in October 1995, SEBI constituted a committee on certification of securities market intermediaries to lay down standards of certification persons operating in the capital market, which is a part of the financial institution reform expansion, abbreviation is FIRE, under the USA. And the committee submitted its recommendation in May 1997, and the same was approved by the SEBI in 1998. And I must say that we are privileged to have one of the committee members amongst us, Mr. Sharma. And thus, we owe all our certification today to you and your team. The main recommendations of the committee, sir, and if I miss something, sir, please add. The main recommendation I thought relevant to talk today is that examination-based certification on a voluntary basis initially and in due course will be made mandatory. And today it's already mandatory in 17 of the sectors as Mr. Ghosh mentioned in the morning. A single common test for all market intermediaries and specialized tests to be introduced in different participants at a later date as required for the market conditions. Examination can be taken by anyone irrespective of their qualifications, age, employment and experience. The committee also designed an exhaustive syllabus for the examination to test and the understanding of the candidates. And her ability to provide sound advice to the investor. See, that's the underlying thing. Now, let's for a moment, the thing is on capacity building. I thought, I was not very sure what is capacity building in the context of the theme of certification, so I did some research. And capacity building, the UNDP defines as the creation of an enabling environment with appropriate policy and legal frameworks. Institutional development, including community participation, human resources development, and strengthening managerial systems. And UNDP recognizes that the capacity building is a long-term continuing process. Again, continuing process. World Customs Organization, which is an intergovernmental organization, defines capacity building as activities which strengthen the knowledge, abilities, skills, and behavior of individuals and improve institutional structures and processes such that the organizations can efficiently meet its vision and goals in a sustainable way. In short, capacity building is not a one-time activity, or one-time effort. It's a continuous improvement strategy towards creation of a sustainable and effective organization. So have we as an industry created sustainable, effective organization? I believe yes so, and I'll show you how. So coming to the mutual fund intermediaries capacity building in India. Taking a cue from the committee's recommendation, AMFI felt that mutual fund industry needs to have a system of certification that one could establish minimum standards for industry participants and enhance a professional. Little background on that. Navneet Munot mentioned about how MasterGain garnered 4,500 crores. I will tell you a small incident, which was, I think, one of the triggers for this. UTI, at that time there was no other mutual funds, I'm talking about before 1980. UK has a scheme called Master Shares. Master Share first matured in 1983. When it was listed and the listed price was 65 and it was traded on the stock exchange, it was being traded at 105. Today we all understand what the net asset value is and nobody will buy at a premium to an NAV. One would probably buy at a discount to NAV, but those days people were buying at a premium to NAV. That is the kind of lack of awareness of ignorance among the stockbrokers, investors, and even the people who are intermediary. That was one. You can get another scheme called Masterclass. IPO forms were not at short supply, they were sold in the black market. And the 10 rupee IPO, people were buying in the secondary market at premium. So that was a kind of lack of awareness among the people, and there was a need to make people understand what mutual funds are, and today it's a long story, we have come a long way. So as part of AMFI's commitment to enhance standards and professionalism in different areas, AMFI took the initiative of developing the self-study and a testing program for both the distributors and employees, and which was voluntarily adopted by all mutual fund members that time. The committee for was headed by Ajay Kaul, who was the then president of Alliance Capital in India. Ajay Srinivasan, many of you must have heard, who is the top level in Birla. At that time, he was the director, managing director of ICICI, Prudential ICICI then. Ashish Chauhan, who was that time in National Stock Exchange. And this committee took the help of D.C. Anjaria. I'm not mentioning his name here, but he must acknowledge he was one of the first directors of UTI Institute of Capital Markets. He made a workbook, and the MP workbook was very popular and was the basis for MP certification. MP commenced its certification in July 2000 with the introduction of an automated testing in association with National Stock Exchange, and it was popularly known as MP certification. It's an NCFM module. And in 2001, SEBI accredited MP certification and it was made mandatory. So that was the first certification in the securities market to be made mandatory by the regulator, and it was made compulsory for distributors as well as employees who are engaged in promoting mutual fund products. Employees were given some time and the distributors were given extended time up to made mandatory by 2003, then it was extended to September 2003. But from September 2003 onwards, one cannot come into mutual fund distribution as a distributor or an employee of a distributor without being first certified. This continued till 2010 May, and by the time NISM was established. So in May 2010, SEBI came out with a notification entrusting the entire certification process to NISM. So from June 2010 onwards, the mutual fund certification for the distributor employee is now NISM certification. Series 5A, Series 5B, etc. Just 2 minutes. I will not talk about grandfather category because Mr. Sharma mentioned about it. Then there is a new carrier distributors for whom there is a simplified, much more basic module kind of a thing, so they can promote the simple products. This is the track record, capacity building. If you see March 2003, there were 31 EMCs, and the AUM of the industry was 79,400 crores. In May 2010, when this activity was hired off to NISM, the industry size was 7.4 trillion, 7,43,116 crores. And in December last month, we have crossed 16,46,000 crores. And as I talk to you, my friends, the average AUM of the industry is crossed 17 lakh crores. BSE Sensex, you can see the levels, and the number of NISM certificates issued. I'm not talking about the number of persons certified because the same person can come multiple times. So for mutual fund industry alone, NISM has issued 3,30,000 certificates since inception. In AMFI, currently we have 77,000, I'm not talking about the institutional, but the individual IFAs or individual distributors as we call them, there are 77,000 mutual fund distributors, and employees who are engaged with the mutual fund distributor are 90,000. So, kul milake, the feet on street today is 1,67,000 distributed. All are certified. So, the point is that I want to say that it has been a very successful journey, and capacity building, I believe, we have gone a long way, but there is still a long way to go. Because in comparison with the insurance industry, the insurance industry has more than 20 lakh, they are close to 22 lakh agents. As agents, we have just 1,50,000 feet on street. So we have a long way to go, but I'm sure that with the atmosphere being conducive, we will do that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kino sir, very much. I would ask you some questions which I feel would be pertinent in view of the comments we have. My first question is to this is about what I also talked in my comments, and this is also talked about that the need is not some kind of a wasted certification. It's about creating an entire ecosystem of where the investors and the sellers and manufacturers and everybody need to become cases. NISM is doing to create such an ecosystem for an overall capacity.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's basic or entry-level exams are just the beginning. You know, they kind of create a need, as people were saying, that it gets people started into thinking that training is something that is needed, that education is useful. I think that's the part that has been played. There was a time when people did not really understand either the need of, even the need of reading a book. They would just sit and learn on the job. So I think that changes with the entry-level exams. But that is only the beginning. So one has to move from there on to a higher level and specialized functions. And all of them can also be mandated, or they can be used as a career-enhancing effort from candidates as well as from the employers. That's something which obviously is the next step, and NISM is working towards that, something which we've seen today as well. The other thing is to look at, you know, the ecosystem is beyond just the market. It's also going to include people who are going to join the industry tomorrow. So working with the business schools and you know, graduate schools, to ensure that the children and the students that are coming out of there have skills which make them employable, because one of the problems with India is that while there are a lot of people, you know, even engineers and MBA graduates coming out of colleges, they don't have skills which are needed by employers. NISM is working towards bridging that gap by working with schools as well as with the employers to ensure that that this gap is filled. You know, we have the industry programs that we are supporting, as well as Professor Kurvi is here. We are looking at maybe working with banks to provide finishing schools so that the people who the employees that are joining are job ready from the beginning.
Thank you both very much. My next question would be Mr. Richard's topic. We have got so many certificates for people entering into individual market segments. But there is a huge spectrum, or sub-spectrum of knowledge that is needed, which we can call as hygiene factors, like we should know AML, KYC, emissions, we should know about it.
I think that's, thank you for that question. I think it's a very pertinent one, because it really boils down to two things: hearts and minds, or box ticking. Now, hearts and minds is hard to create, because you have to have a cultural and a universal acceptance of a particular issue or particular circumstances. That can sometimes take a long time to achieve, sometimes one or two generations. But I think that, going to the direct question, I believe that if you go into an industry, now I'm a great believer in apprentices, and again, going back to the skills thing, that's what apprenticeships were started. In fact, in England now, or in Britain generally, apprenticeships have really started to rear their head again, because people realise that professionalism cannot be overrated. And professionalism doesn't mean to say attitudes, it means to say skills as well, are so central to core activity of the market. I think going to this question here, I think there should be an entry-level qualification, certainly until an entry-level understanding is there. Now, you know, we don't want to, when a poor kid comes out of university, it's absolutely shattered, or she's shattered, she's done this, he's done that, blah, blah, then you're going to hit them with another set of examinations. You know, this has to be a combination of expectation on the entry-level and education. You just put education in, you know, a monkey can be taught to a certain degree. A really bright monkey can be taught even more. Education is fine. It's how you put it in practice, how you walk the talk. Walking the talk is what it really, that's what changes markets, walking the talk. So I think if you can actually instill through, and I can't, now is not the forum to discuss how exactly to do this, but given us still an environment where the new entry knows what is expected, and then to a degree gives them an entry level qualification just to make sure at least some fundamental areas we do know. That is the way to go, I think. But I don't think we can over examine this. It has to be much more central, more core to the central idea. That sometimes takes some innovative thinking and a little bit of a long time.
Thank you very much for your comments. One issue which I had been facing when I was a curator, that we went through agonizing moments before we declared any particular certificate as mandatory. And it's not an easy decision. And that is where the crux of the criticism of both of Adam Smith and Department of Commerce report is coming. Well, that adds costs. And why is costs are added? Because the qualifications and certifications are not transportable, are not transportable across state borders in the US or national borders or otherwise. So I have one question. Do you think it would be a good idea for certifiers of the world to create an international organization among themselves? So, and to say that we have, these are my standards, and so like that, your certificate, what is that? It is kind of a transported over sometimes, something that I have spoke for the certifiers.
I think it's an excellent question, and I fully agree that there is a need for that. Today, of course, in India, we are not a part of the Asia Fund passport, but you must have read in a paper a few days back that you must have been a discussion about fund passporting. Many of you may be aware there is ASEAN fund passport and APEC fund passport, where there is a cross-border investment possible. Today, a foreigner cannot directly invest in India except for FII rule. But once the fund passporting comes, the opportunities will open up. And having a kind of a certification which is accredited across the borders would be a great something to have for our distributors and our intermediaries. I think it's something that we should really start thinking about. And NISM being now having collaboration with organizations and goodies, I think it's a good point to start.
Thank you, Finisar, very much for such a positive response on this question. My next question would be to Navneet. Because you are CIO and you are being large staff, or perhaps you believe there also something. What happens when the times are come? So the first budget which gets cut is a training budget. So although all of us know that that slack of time is the time when we can do the real capacity. When you are flooded with work, capacity building doesn't happen at that point. So how to get it across to the senior management, so that you care, slack is the time for the capsule.
So, Penny reminded us about the SEBI disclaimer for the mutual funds, the disclaimer that has been given, which has to be put across on any publication, any reporting, anywhere you mention about our fund. On a lighter note, I remember in one of the first marathon that we ran, we had a t-shirt and we had our logo. Our compliance officer said, please put mutual funds subject to market. And I'm saying on a serious note, they actually put that. So the compliance officer said, I won't take this. So I would say that saying that mutual funds are subject to market risk, similarly, I think everybody should be told that not undergoing regular training is subject to a serious career risk. I think the people understand that even if they have to pay money, the organization is not, I think people should constantly keep doing it. But even from an organization's perspective, sir, you were talking about the cost aspect. I think I heard the word cost in your previous question. I think putting up a pollution control equipment, is that a cost or is that an investment? Putting, let's say, something which improves the labor safety, I mean, one day the plant will close down, you'll become a union carbide if you don't do that. I think the similar thing here, I mean, this is not a cost, and this is the biggest investment you can make. We are a knowledge industry. I think if we can't invest in this, where else we are investing? And I think we are moving in a future in a few years down the line where so far it's like, I have a certain fund, I have a blue chip fund and I'm selling it. But I think in a few years time it's going to be completely different where the customer has this need and I need to design something for that. And then the whole world is moving towards that. And that's why an Airbnb or an Uber or most of these guys are far more successful than lot, and they are disrupting the traditional businesses because they are understanding that. And the same thing applies to us. If you don't understand it before, I think our industry will have a serious challenge.
I'll just add a little bit to that. So my understanding is, you know, when we say slack, it's not really a slack in the market because, you know, it's actually a change which is happening in the market, and that's where business models need to go through a transition. And so the time that people take to adjust to that new business model is what, you know, ends up being called as a slack usually. And that's the time when organizations actually need to invest much more in training and retraining, and, you know, because if you're changing the business model slightly, tweaking it around, so a lot of training and retraining needs to happen. And if you fail to do that, the result is that, you know, when the new transformed world starts to become more active, then you will be left out and you will really, you know, not be as prominent as what you were earlier, and you might just end up losing. So I think it is a smart management to understand this, that Slack is actually a change of environment happening and not really, you know, a simple, you know, slowdown, because, you know, the world really doesn't slow down, it just changes. And so you need to do training and you need to invest more into it.
Half a minute more. I talked about that, you know, the people who were in early 90s. One of the challenge I think, which is with large number of public sector in general, and maybe true before a lot of the private organizations also, this whole problem of over experience, under expert. Because people have, so when you keep growing and based on the experience, but you haven't really undergone as many trainings or whatever, haven't kept pace. And I think a lot of these NPA issues, I keep thinking, maybe, I think, well, of course, one can talk about the economic slowdown, government policy, whatever. But maybe somewhere, I think, the kind of training in terms of how the credit has changed, how credit should be assessed, how it should be managed, I think we didn't keep pace. So let's say, we're lending to a steel company because we thought for 30, 40 years things have been okay, without realizing that in China capacity is going 5 times, how will that guy compete? It has become NPA. So I think that regular training, because you think that I've been a banker for 30 years, I don't have to learn. I think somewhere has we paid a price.
That's very heartening. NISM won't have any difficulty in balancing his budget.
last question. We have all talked about training of the sellers, the distributors, the employees, and all those things. The issue what we found in 2007 global financial crisis was this the buyers didn't have an idea what they are buying. So, and especially for complex products, would it be a good idea to say that if you want to buy OTC Forex derivative, just do a course in derivative for pricing before you buy this product?
I think I'll give two answers to that. One is a theoretical answer and one is a practical answer. You know, the theory and would say that, you know, yes, we should try to somehow regulate it, somehow understand that the investor who's buying the product is actually understanding what he's getting into, which could be either through a certification or a course or something like that. But on the practical side is that, you know, when he's getting into something, if you make it even more tougher for him to, you know, get into it, the options are going to be we'll have a few options and he might just choose to go through the other route rather than, you know, going through this route. So I think the way that SEBI has done it in India, and that's a very good way to do it, is that, you know, you start defining ticket sizes. And you start assuming that a guy who's investing a larger amount of money has better knowledge because he has access to more resources or he has access to more advisors and stuff like that who are on his side, and, you know, he's able to do it. I think that's a little more practical way where you're trying to, you know, get resources who might be already qualified and certified in the industry to advise him, and he takes that advice and then goes through it rather than, you know, he tries to do it himself, because, you know, if we try to do everything ourselves, we might not be competent enough to do it.
Okay, thanks, Vineet. And I'm sorry that we are overshooting the mark of the time, but now my throw it open to the audience, sir, to ask any questions. Yes, sir.
Good afternoon. This is G.C. Sharma. Yeah. I do the education from National Staff Institute. I have two, three observations and futuristic suggestions for the consolidation of the panel. One, that the NSA through CBSE, 9th and 10th class, and 11th and 12th class, we already provide certification as a part of the curriculum. 11th and 12th class, we teach capital market, derivative market, and mutual funds. And I'm happy to inform you that some of these students, they do even much better in this score, even than the MBA grads across the NCLM system when we take, because MBA grads also take the exams. We also got with 25 plus universities, around 15 to 20 certificates integrated into DBA and MBA financial markets. So NSE that day became the first one in the world where a stock exchange has integrated the certificates of the stock exchange capital market into the curriculum of the university, and the university simply credits this course given by the NCLM system. Third, I also want to bring to the few observations and suggestions for the future. Now the government of India is also aware that they have lost two schemes for employment purpose. One is through NSDC, National Skill Development Corporation, and second through National Skills Qualification Framework. The National Skills Qualification Framework has gone to 10 levels, 1 to 4 levels are for the schools.
Ask
the
question.
Yeah. Actually, it was a suggestion for the futuristic capacity building also. So the for the aspiration part, the level 5 to 8 and 9 to 10 could be a good idea for integrating our NSM modules for capacity building in the college and university system. Thank you.
Any other question? And please make the question specific and direct it to a person if you want.
Thank you. My name is Chandru Badrinarayan from MSCI. I just wanted to pick up from the last question Mr. Saran asked on the education of the investors. You spoke about the complex products. But I think, you know, even on the basic products, a lot of people get chipped. Time to time, and that does actually have a systemic risk for the markets. Mutual funds and through SEBI are having the investor awareness programs, but could it also transform into some kind of a certification in which at least investors ask certain questions to their advisors, which can be more useful?
Absolutely, but you know, as you said, you have mandated that a customer needs to pass something before investing, but beyond that, all the education and you should understand the risk. So, you know, the effort should be that you understand the risk so that you find an advisor who knows what he's advising you. So, you have to create that system where the advisor is knowledgeable and trustworthy, and the customer knows that this product is complex enough and there are risks attached and he needs help and there is somebody he can go to for that.
Okay, I have the follow-up question because a lot has been done on the certifications of the industry participants, but not on the investor side. So just what he, asked, how do you change the mindset? You have at multiple times talked about the ecosystem. Ecosystem will only flourish when they are the industry participants as well as the investors are trained. So in India particularly, we have, two sets of people who know, who don't know. So we are safe. But how do we change the mindset of the people who don't know that they don't know? So there, the people, investors work on quick, get rich quick schemes and they work on, tips and all. So the whole system will improve when people become more educated. So what NISM is doing to improve that sort of a mindset for those investors?
The investor education effort that, you know, we've spoken about yesterday as well is aimed at getting an investor to understand the, you know, returns potential from the market, but also the risks of the marketplace. And the effort is that. So, you know, there is a number of things that are being done
by an ISM and many other organizations to support.
I'll just add to that briefly. So, you know, investor education is one through the entire education piece where you don't go and, you know, write tweak whatever is to be done. And second, which has been very effectively also done, is that, you know, through control. So, you know, what are the kind of charges you can put on a product, what kind of transparency you need to maintain, to control on the entire fund management in case of, you know, insurance or anything else. So, there is a lot of work which the regulators are also doing in trying to make the products, you know, more and more investor friendly. So, that's also a investor protection group which is coming in. So, it's not just one thing, and just to answer your question, I don't think we'll ever have a situation where everybody will know what they are doing. So, it's always a journey, and that journey, I think, will continue maybe forever.
Thank you so much. I think, I know there's a lot of questions that everybody wants to ask, but there's a lunch and, you know, all the gentlemen are all joining us for lunch, so you have questions you can directly ask individual people. So let me first thank Mr. Seven for the wonderful moderation. Gentlemen, in the panel, you had a fabulous discussion engrossing. I really loved it. I'm sure everybody else has loved it. One thing I want to tell you is that Namrit had a very important point. We cover banks, Moody's covers banks globally. One of the things we realized is most people with experience realize they know stuff, but actually they don't know stuff. So some of the banks came to us to ask how do we really know if people really know at senior level. So we use something called a diagnostic tool, which is called a credit coach. Any person who's underwriting credit at whatever levels, 5 million, 10 million, 50 million dollars, actually goes through a diagnostic testing tool. We give him an actual case study, which could be from their own bank where things have gone wrong, and ask him to take a decision. And how does he make a decision? And it uses to test people around 16 parameters of credit decisioning skills. Skills, knowledge, and third, the behavioral traits of taking judgment calls. And you could be surprised to know senior credit risk officers who underwrite $30-40 million of credit actually fail. They don't get it. So the point that I'm trying to say is that corporates need to therefore actually require to put in practices to test people continuously, because the world is changing, expert is changing, as Navneet said. And we have the expertise to support a lot of organizations in this regard. So a little bit of things. So let's enjoy a lovely Indian lunch and come back later next 1 hour for the next session. Thank you so much.